This video likely could not have happened this year without the support of my Patreon subscribers. Thank you to everyone who subscribed this year, and of course, a special shout out to everyone on this list who signed up for my top tiers. I know a father isn't supposed to choose favorites among their children, but you're my favorite. Support the habit and get all sorts of bonus content and the occasional ass kissing like this from your old pal Buckley at patreon.com/doseofbuckley. Last year, I came up with a new way to present the worst songs of the year. Some people liked it, while others were upset that it wasn't a top 10 list. Gonna let you in on a little secret. Every top 10 list on the internet is just 10 items given an arbitrary rank. Or do you guys think there's a scientific method behind WatchMojo's selection process? Of course there isn't. They pick 10 items, say, I guess this one's better than that one, whatever, and slap a video together and you comment, oh my god, I can't believe they think number 2 is better than number 5! And guess what? They knew you'd disagree with the numbers and comment, increasing their engagement. You fell right into their trap. My annual 10 worst songs lists have always just been an excuse to end the year by making fun of a handful of songs released that year. So, if the award show format isn't quite your thing, just pretend I'm saying numbers instead of award names. It's the same thing. Or rank them from best to worst in the comments section. Then I'll get that sweet, sweet engagement. Anyway, here's my list of the worst songs of 2020. The Madonna Award for Worst Performing New Music goes to Katy Perry, Daisies. I'm the long shot, I'm the Hail Mary, why can't it be me? Oh, Katy, going back to her dark horse days, pretending like she's a real underdog in this business after putting out 3 number 1 albums and 14 top 10 hits. Yeah, real long shot. But this song is kind of like anticipation for her new album. There's a bunch of build-up with absolutely no payoff. They said I'm going nowhere, trying to get me out. Took those sticks and stones, showed them I could build a house. They tell me that I'm crazy, but I'll never let them change me. So they cover me in daisies, daisies, daisies. All right, here we go. This goes into a thumping beat and gets really exciting here, right? No, just like sales for the album, it kinda just sputters out. In fact, the cover me in daisies part was the chorus. That was supposed to be the exciting part. And what's funny is this, I'll never let them change me shit. They don't have to, you changed yourself. Oh, I'm gonna try and make more subdued, more artistic and serious music to show people I've grown. Well, I'll tell you what ain't growing. Your bank account was shit like this. This album, Smile, sold about 50,000 copies in its first week, a far cry from the millions of copies of One of the Boys, Teenage Dream, and Prism that you moved. This album is also her first to not have a single top 10 hit, and the only top 20 hit, the pretty forgettable but hilariously ironically named Never Really Over, came out last year before this album was even announced. Now, Katy, I know how it feels to slide headfirst into irrelevance. Of course, I don't know what it's like to already have been super rich before my irrelevance, but at this point, every new Katy Perry song is like watching Tyson continue to fight after his prime. You know it's not gonna go well, but you gotta check it out anyway. At least Tyson would go on to create a hilarious cartoon, so that's something to think about. Maybe Katy Perry could do a cartoon where her and a group of other 2010s pop stars whose careers are fading become international jewel thieves who are always just one step ahead of a special crime unit staffed by 2000s R&B stars like Akon and Usher. If that was on Netflix, I'd watch it. The Asher Roth Award for Most Unnecessary Performance by a White Rapper goes to Jack Harlow. What's poppin'?
What's poppin'? Who you brand new whip, just hopped in. I got options. I can pass that bitch like Stockton.
Who still says what's poppin'? You know, I'm so sick of this ironic, look at me, I'm a white dorky dude, but I rap shit. After Lil Dicky did it, we really didn't need more than one. Guy looks like the kid from The Sandlot grew up, and the lyrics couldn't be more generic. With lyrics about smoking weed,
me and my amigos got that free smoke on the West Coast, yeah, I'm talking about pre-roll.
Spending money, but of course, because he's a white dorky guy, he's gotta do the Macklemore thing and reference somewhere kinda lame.
Spending money at the club like Sam's.
Might be the first mention of Sam's Club in a rap song. And he's got to bring up getting bitches.
Dark hair bitch, she look like she go, she do.
By the way, on Genius, he annotated his own lyrics, which feels kind of like wearing your own merchandise to your concert, and confirms that he's aroused by a character from Kim Possible, among other cartoons. Again, this, I'm a nerdy white dude rapping about white nerdy stuff, like jerking off to cartoon characters. No thanks. Anyway, of course, he also has to mention that he's got a big dick.
She heard my deep stroke. She said, babe, does it hurt when I deep throw?
It does.
Wait, it hurts him? Man, dude needs to get some girls that know how to keep their teeth off it. And the final rap trope, people are jealous of him.
I feel resentment from every direction. Even some homies be wearing expressions.
Congrats, Jack. I think you fit them all in there. To try and legitimize himself as one of the boys, he also got Lil Wayne, Tory Lanez, and DaBaby to do a remix, which I guess worked. The song ended up at number 2 on Billboard, but as always, it adds nothing to the genre. Man, even his name's boring. Jack Harlow. Could be your accountant. This guy's so generic, he shouldn't even have a name. They should have just called this rap song by a white rapper, toss his album in the fucking dollar store beside the store brand chips and the knockoff chocolate bars. The Florida Georgia Line Award for Most Pandering Song goes to Florida Georgia Line, I Love My Country.
Out here ain't nothing but woods and water, drop a deer from a stand, catch a fish with a bobber, drink a beer out the can, liquor out the bottle, how the good Lord intended it, yes he did.
Ah yes, having a Coors out of the can and Jack Daniels straight from the bottle, just like it says in the Bible. This whole song basically could have been hunting, fishing, drinking beer, America. Just repeat that for 4 minutes, and every country radio station from Tennessee to Tulsa will be bending over backwards to play this one.
I love my country, I love my country. Six strings and fiddles and ski from Kentucky. We keep it funky, we like how it sounds. Monday to Sunday, yeah, I love my country.
Is there any other country in the world that produces music about how great their country is? I mean, besides North Korea forcing children to sing songs about their glorious dear leader. Like, it's kind of weird, right? Canadians aren't making songs about how great our maple syrup harvest is. And the only British song I know about the Queen calls her a fascist. But this is country music's bread and butter right here. Pandering to real Americans, not them city liberals. We don't need no air-conditioned offices. Our AC's the wind through the forest while we hide in a tree and wait for a deer to come by and shoot it with a high-powered rifle. That's our God-given right to own. And always this shit. They want us to be sorry for loving America, but I ain't sorry because there ain't nothing to be sorry about. I don't want you to apologize for loving the place you just so happened to be born in and had no choice or say in the matter. But a quick, I'm sorry for writing cheesy, pandering, fluffy bullshit to make millions of dollars by selling it to working class Americans while pretending I'm just one of them would be nice. And now, in the interest of equal time, sort of, the Neil McCoy Award for Worst Political Song goes to Demi Lovato, Commander in Chief.
Won't give up, stand our ground. We'll be in the streets while you're bunkering down. Loud and proud, best believe we'll still take a knee while you're Commander in Chief. Honestly, if I did the things you do,
yeah, I understand what you were going for here. You don't like the president, and you think the Democrats will be better, as if any politicians are actually good. But perhaps when singing a song deriding the right, maybe don't use words or phrases like stand your ground, which conjures images of Florida's classic stand your ground law, and George Zimmerman needing a gun to take down a 140-pound kid armed with iced tea, or loud and proud, which just makes me think about the Proud Boys, and was also just used in that Florida Georgia Line song, so that's kind of funny too. But there's something off about the whole thing. Like a person singing a song they're making up in their head as they go, and they're just trying to fit as much into each line as possible.
'Cause there are people worse off that have suffered enough. Haven't they suffered enough? But you can't get enough of shutting down systems for personal gain, fighting fires with liars and praying for rain. Do you get off on pain? We're not pawns in your game.
I think I've suffered enough just from listening to this. So Demi released this on October 14th, less than 1 month before the election. Trump was elected president in 2016, so you had 4 years to write this, and yet it feels extremely rushed. Like a homework project left until the last minute. Then someone went, oh, fuck, the election's in like, oh, fuck, in like 3 weeks. Shit, we just gotta release this. Okay, well, the best we could do is about, I don't know, 5 notes on a piano. Well, you know, we'll just kind of play those slowly and dragged out. And then, okay, Demi, you'll sing this weird poem that sounds like it was written by someone in grade 12 who just learned about politics. Okay, we'll shove it out the door and everyone will think that it's just really topical. By the way, complaining about doing things for personal gain is kind of funny when you left ads for your CDs and a puzzle on the YouTube video. Make sure you vote and also buy some merch with my face on it! But I guess if you got even one more person to vote, it was all worth it. Now, if only we could vote to stop pop singers from making piano ballads where all the lyrics are just based on trending topics they saw on Twitter. The Alan Jackson Award for Most Tone-Deaf Cover goes to Poppy. All the Things She Said. So we'll get this part out of the way. I hate covers that don't really add anything, or just try and sound exactly like the original. It's pointless. It'd be like remaking a movie shot for shot with all the actors trying to do impersonations of the originals. Poppy, the eccentric viral internet star, who basically stole Baby Metal's gimmick in late 2019 and has been nominated for a Grammy for Best Metal Performance for it, yeah, that's a thing that happened this year, doesn't change anything about the song, doesn't add anything new or interesting, and even layers her own voice over itself to kind of sound like two people are singing, as the original is performed by two singers, Russian one-hit wonders Tattoo. But here's where the tone-deaf part comes in. She released this song in honor of Pride Month, because the song and video's lesbian overtones back in 2002 got it banned from TV or edited to remove the girls kissing. But just in case you haven't heard this over the last 18 years since the song came out, Tattoo weren't actually lesbians. They were pretending to be lesbians because their label thought it would sell. The guys would be like, oh, they're so hot and they're making out with each other. That's so hot. I gotta go buy that CD. Maybe there's more pictures of them in the liner notes being hot. And one of them said this in an interview where she said she would not accept a gay son. And a man has no right to be a fig. Two girls together, not the same thing as the two men together. It seems to me that lesbians look aesthetically much nicer than two men holding their hands or kissing. But I want to say that I'm not against gays. I just want my son to be a real man, not a fig. That's what you're releasing in honor of Pride Month? Jesus. Maybe for February, in honor of Black History Month, you can do a cover of Johnny Rebel's Coontown. The Depeche Mode Award for Biggest Guilty Pleasure Song goes to Pow Foo featuring Biba Doobie, Deathbed, brackets, Coffee for Your Head. Everything about this is hate bait. The girl who sings the hook is named Biba Doobie, and I don't know if that's her real voice or a pitch-shifted high voice that was annoying when songs were doing that in the 2000s. See also Hard Knock Life. But she sounds like Betty Boop fucked one of the chipmunks. Probably Simon. Low-key, you know, he was the one getting all that rodent pussy after the shows. Anyway, her part is a sample of a song that already exists, borrowed by a white rapper, Pow Foo, which is also a pretty stupid name, a la Eminem with Stan using the Dido song Thank You. And yet, whenever it comes on the radio, I nod along to it like a fucking idiot. I've been praying for forgiveness, you've been praying for my health. When I leave this earth,
hoping you'll find someone else. Cause yeah, we still young, there's so much we haven't done. Getting married, start a family, watch your husband with his son. I wish it could be me, but I won't make it off this bed. I hope I go to heaven so I see you once again. My life was kinda short, but I got so many blessings. Happy you were mine, it sucks that it's all ending.
I don't know what it is with white rappers annotating all their own songs on Genius, but Pow Fu, this Logan Paul looking motherfucker, confirms that the song is about a person dying and how he hopes his wife or girlfriend or whatever will move on and find a new guy. You know how much I bitch about hearing the same thing over and over? I've never heard a song where a rapper said he wanted to be cucked from beyond the grave. So you gotta give it up for something original. But yeah, I should hate everything about it. Vocals layered over vocals.
I've been praying for forgiveness, you've been praying for my health.
The fact that it's kind of religious, aside from the going to heaven line, there's also this.
Sundays went to church, and Mondays watched a movie.
And again, Beefy Doobie or Betty Boopy or Bawa to Bowie or whatever the fuck her name is so annoying. So why don't I fucking hate this with the burning fury of 1,000 liberals on a Trump tweet? Fuck you, Baba Booey and Pow Fu. Fuck your song. I'll probably only listen to it 10 more times and then that's it. Alright, let's give away some quicker awards before we get to the main event here. The Hurricane Chris Award for Worst Song Title goes to Lil Mosey, Blueberry Faygo. Pretty forgettable, by-the-book rap song, lots of stuff about money, guns, and fucking bitches, as always, from someone no one in the mainstream has ever heard of before. Some rap nerd's gonna go, well, Buckley, he blew up on SoundCloud like 3 years ago. Good for him. This is his first real hit, reaching number 8 on Billboard. But this is what they're doing now. They've run out of ideas for song names, and they're just like, oh, fuck, what do we got in the fridge here? Eggs? That's not a song title. Leftover Chinese. Someone's gonna say that's racist. Expired milk? That might be a good one if I ever get into a beef with 80s rappers audio too. Ah, here we go. Blueberry Faygo. Well, I'm sure at least the Juggalos approve, but good job, Lil Mosey. You toss it up for the kids on TikTok to do a stupid dance to, and you got yourself a hit that's as shitty as the soda it's named after. The Chainsmokers Award for successfully going from meme status to having a real career goes to Doja Cat for Say So. In an alternate universe somewhere, Doja Cat releases the song Moo, which you may know better as the Bitch I'm a Cow song, and then never manages to go any further in her career than that. And every time she tries to put out another song, people just yell, moo, at her, or, I'm not a cat, I don't say meow, and that's it. Instead, she got Dr. Luke, under a fake name because, you know, the Kesha thing, to produce this, yet another funk and disco-inspired song for 2020, thanks The Weeknd and Dua Lipa, that says, we're not done ripping off the 70s yet! And how awful is the processing on that hook? Is Doja Cat actually a talented singer? Maybe, but who could tell? Nearly every vocal in the song is so heavily processed that it's the musical equivalent of spraying Febreze all over your apartment before you have a girl over so she thinks that you actually clean. But congrats, Doja Cat. You did what Rebecca Black and Bad Baby could never do. You got people to take you seriously. And the Yin Yang Twins Award for the most pointless radio edit goes to Cardi B and Megan Thee Stallion. WAP. Yeah, you dealing with some wet and gushy. Bring a bucket and a mop for this wet and gushy. Give me everything you got for this wet and gushy. So, when you make the most controversial song of 2020, but you still want it to get radio play, what do? Apparently, you make it sound worse. Wet ass pussy sounds kind of gross, just because of the word ass in there. Like, what the fuck is ass pussy? Isn't that just ass? Yes, yes, I know, it's slang. Calm down, kiddies. But wet and gushy sounds kind of slimy and squishy, like gack for any 90s kid watching. Or like a pipe's broken and it's just gushing out. And there's a level of wetness that's just too much. If it's soaking through to the bottom of the mattress, That's a problem that putting a tarp down isn't going to solve. Now, I already did a musical autopsy of the actual song earlier in the year, and if you're like, so wait, Buckley, if you're talking about it now, are you saying you're not making it the worst song of the year because it was the worst song of the year? No, I'm not, because as I talked about in my previous video, I just thought it was poorly marketed, that if it were presented as a comedy, it's fantastic in its own way. And maybe the edited version is meant to be another layer of comedy, because in the official video on YouTube, they got rid of all the swearing and some of the more suggestive parts with lyrics like this. I love that they cut out dangly thing in throat, but they're fine with it's going in dry and it's coming out soggy. But for the video, they still keep Cardi and Megan's tits and ass in. Is this to mock YouTube? Like, hey, you don't like swearing anymore? That's too adult? Okay, we'll take that out. Hopefully it doesn't distract anyone from this close-up of my massive rack. It's fine for the kids now. But I still can't imagine a radio station actually playing this. Not without getting a lot of calls. I had to explain to my kids what a wet and gushy is. Or at least that might have happened if anyone still listened to the radio. Alright, now, because there are still going to be babies going, but I need a countdown, any change from convention is too difficult for me. Hasn't 2020 had enough change in our lives? I'll give you these last three as a countdown. Consider these the three worst songs of 2020. Also, I'm still going to give them awards. Number 3, and the Lil Nas X Award for short songs that still aren't short enough, goes to Katy Perry, Smile. Yeah, I'm faithful. Scratch that, baby, I'm faithful. Gotta say it's really been a while, but now I got back that smile. How the hell did they start making songs 2.5 minutes long and somehow make them still as repetitive, maybe more repetitive, than the 3.5, 4-minute songs? The part I just played repeats 4 times, so 1 minute 20 seconds of this song, half the length of it, is just that part. And another 40 seconds is just a slightly modified version of the hook repeated, which happens a little later in the song. Huh, I wonder if she's thankful. If only there was a part of the song that told us. And then, there's the verses. Every day. Groundhog Day, going through motions, felt so fake. Not myself, not my best, felt like I failed the test. Man, what modern pop fans don't love references to Bill Murray movies from 1993. Anyway, it sounds like it was written for a rap feature, but either no one wanted to, or, hey, COVID's been making everyone want to save money. Maybe they just didn't want to spend it getting Summer Walker or some shit. So they just said, all right, Katy, kind of sing-talk it, I guess, and we'll stick this awful processing on it, and, well, what the hell, we'll throw some record scratches in there as well. People still think that's really cool, right? I mean, you're basically old school now. When was your first hit? 2008? You're basically ancient now. But this song also couldn't have come out at a worse time. People are dying, losing their jobs, their businesses. But hey, Katy, I'm glad to hear you got your smile back. We were all worried in 2020 that a multi-millionaire engaged to a very well-known actor might have still been sad. Number 2, and the Ray Shrimmer Award for Most Manufactured Hit Song sponsored by Pepsi, Amazon, and British Knights goes to Drake, Toosie Slide. Go right foot up, left foot slide, left foot up, right foot slide. Basically, I'm saying either way we about to slide. Hey, can't let this one slide. Everything about this song will always remind me of Aisha Tyler, the woman who voices Lana on Archer, on stage at a video game awards show going, let's make a meme. One does not simply make a meme. They didn't even try to mask it. This was a song made for TikTok with no other purpose than to game the system to get to number one, which it only managed to do for a week. Meanwhile, Roddy Ricch's The Box became a meme accidentally and spent 11 weeks at the top after TikTok glommed onto it. So the song he paid someone to make a dance for, made for TikTok, couldn't even game the system properly. Outside of that, the song itself is garbage. The little dance part itself feels like he got bored writing the hook halfway through. Basically, I'm saying either way we bad to slide. Like, whatever, you just slide or something. I gotta go count my money again. Someone make me a dance for this and call me when it's done. And we also get a bunch of his delusional gangsta shit that he started with, started from the bottom.
200 shooters on my brother's block. Oh, yeah.
You know, with all your money, maybe you should buy your brother a house in a nicer neighborhood. You know, like the one you live in now.
I could dance like Michael Jackson. I could get you the passion. It's a thriller in a trap. Where we from?
Once again, you are not from the trap. You lived in a nice neighborhood in Toronto. You played hockey as a child, which is not cheap. And you went to high school with someone whose dad was an acting agent who got you a job in Canadian TV when you were 15. You weren't slanging and banging in the trap. And you could dance like Michael Jackson? Maybe if Michael Jackson was your wheelchair-bound character from Degrassi, your little slide step song does not demonstrate that you can dance like MJ. But you can certainly groom like he did, huh? Nah, it's totally normal for a 30-year-old man to text teenage girls like Millie Bobby Brown and Billie Eilish. Or meet a girl when she's 16 and wait until she's 18 to date her, like Bella Harris. But what can I say? I can't just let this one slide, eh?
Can't let this one slide.
For a good chunk of the year, I thought this was gonna be my worst song of 2020. Then I heard this next one. The worst song of 2020, and the winner of the Gary Glitter Award for the artist that still somehow gets their music played, goes to 6ix9ine, featuring Nicki Minaj, Trolls. Go ahead and tell me if you understood any of that without needing to see the lyrics. This way, I'll know how many people who watch this are liars. At best, I thought that one part said, "Keep on throwing that cat." And that yeah, yeah, yeah part. God damn, that's hard to listen to. All I can think of is if they do another update of Dumb and Dumber, this should be the scene.
Wanna hear the most annoying sound in the world?
So then everyone's favorite mumble rapper tries to sing, which goes about as well as you'd expect. Why would TMZ show up to cover a rapper smoking reefer? What year is this? No one gives a shit about weed anymore. Shit's legal in Michigan. But anyway, same as I talked about with Doja Cat, they've slapped so much processing on this that it's fucking RoboCop. It's more machine than man. And then, this happens. Rhyming fuck with fuck? Out fucking standing. The credits say this is still 6ix9ine. Like, fresh out of jail, he couldn't afford whatever little money Lil Jon's gotta be charging for a feature these days, so he did his own impression of him. That's pretty generous of him. Buying things for women who have sex with his friends? He doesn't even want them for himself. Probably because they aren't 13 years old. Eh, Tekashi? And of course, Nicki Minaj shows up, 2 months before WAP came out, to be way more disgusting.
Yeah, eat it, Cookie Monster. He a slave to this pussy, call me master. Real wet, I said slurp it like it's pasta.
Slurp it like it's pasta. You got Ben Shapiro talking about how Cardi B should see a doctor if she's too wet. If noodles are coming out, now you got a real problem. This is way worse than WAP. It conjures so many images. I'm just picturing the scene from Lady and the Tramp, except it's My Little Gangsta on one end and Nicki Snatch on the other. And I know I don't know women that well, but I'm pretty confident they don't want to hear this while you're going down on them. Jesus, ball cradling Christ. Anyway, at least 6ix9ine is well aware that people don't like him.
I know you don't like me. You wanna fight me. You don't want no problems at your party, don't invite me.
I mean, as long as the party ain't at a Dave and Buster's before 9 p.m, there shouldn't be any problems, right? Seriously, my understanding is that the rap community hates two things: people who fuck with underagers and snitches. 6ix9ine is both, plus a woman beater. Although, Chris Brown's proven that no one fucking cares about that. But somehow, this motherfucker still has a career. Trolls is a perfect name for this song, that's for sure, since old 6699 is trolling us every time he puts out a new song, and trolling us even harder when they hit number one on Billboard. That's right, this song was number one on Billboard. If there was no better way to express how fucked up 2020 has been, it's that a kid-touching, woman-beating snitch had the biggest song in North America for a week, and everyone was like, yeah, but we got worse shit to deal with. Well, that's it. The worst songs of 2020. And if me talking about 12 songs instead of 10 this year isn't enough, let's bring back this feature. My honorable mentions go to really all the songs I did musical autopsies of earlier in the year, but Justin Bieber's Yummy in particular.
Yeah, you got that yummy, yum, that yummy, yum, that yummy, yummy.
Yeah, always good to describe a woman the same way a child describes a Hot Pocket. Megan Thee Stallion, Body. She says she wrote this in quarantine. All that time with nothing else to do, and this is the best you could come up with for a hook? Hate to see what you would have come up with in a rush. Selena Gomez, Rare.
It feels like you don't care. Why don't you recognize I'm so rare?
Oh yeah, pop singer complaining that they aren't getting the love they feel they deserve? About as fucking rare as an OnlyFans girl. And DaBaby featuring Roddy Ricch, Rockstar.
Let's go. Brand new Lamborghini, fuck a cop car. With a pistol on my hip like I'm a cop.
Yeah.
Have you ever met a real nigga rockstar? This ain't no guitar, bitch, this a Glock.
Ah yes, classic rockstar behavior. Buying Lamborghinis, speeding from the cops, and bragging about owning a Glock. You know, I think that's what Zeppelin's rock and roll was actually all about. Alright, 6-9, what do you keep on throwing?
Hit you like I don't rave,